Eyal Levi here with Nail the Mix and URM Academy, and I am going to unbox none other than Redneck by Lamb of God on the album Sacrament, which incidentally just went gold this year, and was mixed by the legendary, the one and only Machine. And if I sound excited, it's because I am fucking excited. How could you not be excited getting to unbox this? Lamb of God has been one of the most influential, powerful, amazing members of the metal community as a band and as people for the past 15 or more years. I mean, these guys are an institution. Not only one of the best metal bands of all time, but also some of the best people in the industry of all time. And I am honored to have them on Nail the Mix. And I'm honored to have Machine on Nail the Mix. I've always wondered about him. I know lots of people have always wondered about him. So many of us have loved his productions for so long, but it's always been a mystery. And this is going to be the first time that we get a real look into how he works. So, so into it. All right, let's get into what this is. All right, I've got the raw tracks for Redneck right here, and I will show you that they are the tracks. And, just kidding. There we go. Nothing on the mixer. No plugins. Boys and girls, it's raw. And let's just play it raw. Hear what it sounds like. Sounds like a fucking band, but I'll keep going. Right there, I can tell you, this mix is yours to mess up because this is really well produced, really well tracked, really well performed. It's some pinnacle stuff right here. And it reminds me of something that the drummer in my band said to me back in 2007 when we were on tour with Lamb of God during Ozfest. He's like, we're never going to be as big as them because we're never going to be as good as them. And I got kind of mad at him. But then the more I thought about it, the more I heard their riffs, I was like, God damn it, he's right. We will never be as good as them. So kudos to the Lamb of God guys for writing just awesome, awesome metal music throughout the years and for helping show me that I couldn't. All right, let's go on with this. Let's start with drums. So looks like we've got 21 tracks of drums. Let's just solo them out, hear what we've got. Very tight, very controlled recording, which I think is something that you know about Lamb of God recordings. It sounds like there's a million things going on in the drums, and there's always a lot of clarity. Like, you could always hear every little detail of Chris Adler's kit, and just the most insane grooves that seem complicated but somehow move the song forward. It has a very unique way of going about things. But these drums sound great, and I love that snare. Now, I know that this was recorded in a very interesting method, which it's going to be elaborated on a lot more in the live stream because I wasn't there. But I know that a lot of this is done with overdubs. Now, let me dispel a myth about drum overdubs. First of all, you do drum overdubs with good drummers. You cannot really do drum overdubs with bad drummers. If you are doing drum overdubs, it's because your drummer is awesome and you have a particular aesthetic that you're going for and trying to achieve with that drummer. Bad drummers cannot do this shit. They don't have the ability to keep time. They don't have the ability to play drums with only one limb or to have phantom limbs or whatnot. Man, I could just keep on going. All I'm saying is, in order to be able to do overdubbed live drums, you have to be very, very good. Very good. And you have to know exactly what you're playing and why and how and what timing, what velocity, everything. And you have to know the bigger picture the entire time. You can't just do it. And trust me, I have tried doing this with lesser drummers, and it has not gone well. It has gone horribly bad, actually. The only time that I've managed to make this work with a drummer has been with a great drummer, like someone like Kevin Talley or something like that. Like, it's got to be on that level in order for this drum overdub thing to work. So right now, for those of you YouTube warriors who are going to talk shit, know right now that if you're talking shit, it means you've never tried this in real life, because I challenge you to try this in real life. Try this in real life with your drummer, and I bet you're going to come up with a fucking chunk of shit that sounds like horrible drums. Then I want you to try it, hire Kevin Talley or some other badass drummer and try and do it, or Matt Brown or whoever, Alex Runiger, and try to record like this. And you'll notice that it's difficult, but you can get it done. But it's difficult. Anyhow, let's keep going. I ranted, I did. I got excited. So looks like we've got a right, the main kick, and then a right and left double kick. So it seems to me like he's got this layer for the left and rights, and then this for the single kick main action, and then this typewriter sample just backing up these doubles. See what I mean? Like the single hits right there. Or now, it's interesting. This is interesting. This is an arrangement thing. You don't see this too often, but notice how in this riff it goes dun 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 dun. The dun dun is really important. Dun 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 dun. Okay, you notice that on the dun duns, he does put that kick there to double the cymbal that's doing it at the same time. He could just have this typewriter sample going. The typewriter sample is going the whole time through the entire pattern. So why not just keep these down there? See what I'm saying? If we were to take these, and just put them on one line like that. As opposed to, you hear the difference? I'll undo all this. And now listen to the difference with those kicks remaining on the emphasis track. So needless to say, these are very well-arranged drums. They're designed for dramatic effect. So those of you who are coming in thinking, I want my blast beats, I want my double bass at 360 BPM, forget all that. Think about the groove that this is creating and think about the way that this brings the song forward and really creates, I guess, a, I don't want to say a drum machine, but like a mechanical war drum playing behind the music that matches the dynamic peaks and valleys of everywhere that the music needs to go. This is expertly arranged drum work. All right, so the toms are cleaned. Let's see what we got. Ah, I got one of those error messages off screen, scaring me, making me feel like Pro Tools didn't love me anymore, but our love can continue. Let's hear these toms. Yeah, we'll add the snares in. Very good. See what we've got with overheads. Looks like we've got runes, symbols, halls, ride, splash. I'm not sure which ones of these would be considered overheads. So I'm gonna say symbol left and right, maybe. And I'm gonna move them. Oh, did I get that damn error message again? You gotta stop confusing me, Pro Tools. Let's just move these here. Just a guess. Cymbal tracks. So what they were trying to do is to get the cleanest possible take on all these drums. You really should try this sometime. And by the way, the Foo Fighters have recorded records like this. See what else we got with the drums. Got some rooms. Nice, let's give that another spot. So that's like a snare room. Okay. And then what is this all about? I get the feeling that these are different room approaches that are specific to different parts of the drum kit based on what machine was wanting to get. So good luck with these drums. This is a totally different approach than we've ever had on here. But I mean, it is all laid out for you to make it sound incredible. It already sounds pretty damn incredible just the way it is. always one of my favorite riffs. All right, let's get to over the bass. Got one DI here. Solid. A good amp, good distortion. Boom. So you want in a bass player, just solid, aggressive, holding it down. Let's hear that with the drums. Oh, come on. I swear I've done this before. What the hell's going on? Whoops. You guys can make fun of me forever after that. There we go. Now you don't need to make fun of me forever. All right, you hear how tight that bass and that drum is? That's how a rhythm section should sound in this style of music. They should be dead locked like that. Like, how are you going to have sloppy guitars? How are you going to have sloppy anything when your rhythm section is laying down the tight metal thunder like that? Okay, we know the bass rules. Let's check out the guitars. Looks to me like we do not have any DIs. We have some quads. Wait a second. We do have DIs. So we have a left and a right guitar, left and a right DI, and we have some quads over here at the end. I don't know what amps were used, but I'm sure we can ask. But, you know, for now, let's listen to what guitar tone we were given to work with. Let me just say something. The best metal players out there don't need a lot of gain to get the point across because it's in their fucking fingers. Here's a perfect example. That is a medium to low gain riff, and it sounds phenomenal. Works perfectly with the bass. And again, why would you, you could reamp these, but why would you want to? Bring in the drums so we can hear the rhythm section going at it. And we'll go from that faster part in the middle, just because it's fun. When I was saying earlier that in order to have really tight guitars, you need a rhythm section that's this tight. Now when you hear it all together, can you imagine if the bass guitar was kind of flubby or just not not playing exactly the right note in the exact right timing with the exact right feel. And if the drummer was kind of loosey-goosey for a riff that's this speed and this tight and this driving, it just wouldn't work. It would be some limp dick shit. But it's not, because it's Lamb of God. Looks like we've got some wahs here and a lead. Wah. Wah. Nice. Love those. Let's hear them against the rhythm guitar and the bass guitar, just to get an idea for where these fall in. Okay, so here's another little subtle arrangement thing, like I was showing you before on the drums. So that's the riff. It's a descending riff. Down, 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 down. Right? It's this guy, but up here. Sounds fine the way it is. But you add these guys, it just makes it milky. You know what I mean? I don't know what else to say but milky. It's just little arrangement details that take something from good to great, even if it's not like a symphony orchestra with like 180 tracks of who knows what, Martians reading music on Earth for the first time and giving us their language through the songs of whales. Like, these kinds of little details are what will make your productions much better. Just like earlier on, the way that I showed you the dominant kick track versus the non-dominant kick track when it was meant to emphasize the two cymbal hits. This band are expert arrangers. And we've got more of these wah things. Let's see what this one is. Yep. Just not letting it sound like a regular guitar, which is cool. All right, we've got two leads, no DIs. Let's hear what these are all about. Well played, in tune, good feel. Don't mess it up. Awesome. Love it. Let's get into the vocals. Randy Blythe, one of the most iconic front men in all of metal, and a wonderful human being. And if Randy's watching this, thank you for everything in 2007. You probably don't remember me. But Ozfest 2007. So, looks like we've got one main Randy track, a few stereo doubles, and then just some monster layers. But the majority of Randy sounds like just Randy, one Randy. Sometimes one Randy's all you need.
Wow! So goddamn easy to write this! You make it spill on the page!
Because he sounds exactly like himself when he, It's funny. It's like sometimes you have to layer vocalists and layer them and layer them to try to create a sound because there is nothing there. And so you're hoping that through all the layers, something will come about. But then you just have someone like Randy who just does his thing on one track and it's immediately recognizable. And that's why he's Randy Blythe.
Wow! So goddamn easy to write age! But I ain't one to call names! This is a motherfucking invitation!
Looks like the chorus. This is the motherfucking invitation. Yeah, there's the chorus. Let's check it out with the whole band.
And I have to leave! Yes, Randy!
And I have a feeling that he's doing different pitch screams in here. We shall see.
This is a mother. This is a mother. This is a mother. This is a mother.
So those are along the same verses.
This is a motherfuck.
Okay, so you got the pitch versus that growl. Let's see what happens here.
This is a motherfucking invitation.
Where does he say invitation?
This is a motherfucking invitation. This is a motherfucking invitation. This is a motherfucking invitation.
Okay, so you got four of the pitch screams kind of backing up that pseudo melody with the one brutal track kind of giving it to. That's why it sounds the way it does. Gojira, another band that are really great at doing this.
This is a motherfucking invitation. You try me. Just one time you gotta.
And then we've got some strings, I guess. What? Oh, hold on. Unsolo. Had to be some layer of some sort. What's this? Yeah, just a little tension builder. Doesn't need to be very loud, just there to build the tension. Don't snooze on these things. They're in there for a reason. And of course, you can't end you just can't end a Lamb of God song without the crowd applause. All right, everyone. This has been Eyal Levi with the honor of unboxing Redneck by Lamb of God off of the album Sacrament. Machine is the original mixer producer for this album that came out in 2005, I believe. And this will be on a special edition Nail the Mix during August and September of 2018, right now. So if you like this, click the link below and sign up. See you later. See you later. See you later.